Dr. Sangeeta Reddy, President FICCI, Shri Khetan, President ICA, Ms. Geeta Luthra, Senior Advocate and Vice President, ICA, Shri Chawla, the Deputy Secretary General FICCI, and advisor, distinguished arbitrators, distinguished senior advocates, distinguished members of the FICCI and the ICA, and somebody who is not strictly part of arbitration, Sriram Panchu, who is a mediator. Ladies and gentlemen, the electronic and print media. I am indeed delighted to be here. I tend to open all my speeches with this term, but I have never meant it more than today. On the occasion of the third international conference organized by the Indian Council of Arbitration and the Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, wisdom dictates that each brings a unique perspective to the table, and like it is said, the complete picture can emerge only if all the perspectives across the legal spectrum, the judges, academics, and lawyers are combined. I therefore congratulate the ICA and the FICCI for taking the initiative and bringing together all who hold an interest in strengthening the current dispute resolution fraternity in India. I thank the speakers before me for all the kind words. Whether I deserve it or not, you said it, and I thank you for it. Judging can be a difficult task, and judges do what everybody avoids doing, and that is take decisions. Popularity is a mirage for judges. No judge worth his salt aims at popularity. The idea is to resolve a dispute. But there is a dissatisfaction in the outcomes, which results in a hierarchy of appeals, which cannot be avoided. In fact, there is a very interesting story of a solicitor who sent a telegram to his client, "Your case is decided, justice is done." And the client replied, "Appeal immediately." This is something which happens all the while. And therefore, the utmost importance of alternative dispute resolutions. And that is something over which the judiciary has no control, except that it should not interfere with awards. The law has grown in directions which I personally do not endorse, on interference, on the insistence and demand for reasons. The arbitration system is replicating the judicial system. It is mirroring what happens in courts, and I don't think, with the utmost respect, that it was intended to be so. It was not I don't think it was intended that arbitrators should look at pleadings, look at evidence, analyze pleadings, look at precedents, and then deliver their award, which must read like a judgment. And once you deliver an award which reads like a judgment, the interference also is like that towards judgments. Arbitration, I am not very good at etymology, but I think it is intended to mean somebody who knows the subject. The arbitrator should be somebody who knows the subject, who knows the people who have appointed him, who has a broad idea of the dispute, and he simply says, looks at the evidence and says, this should be the result. I think it was meant to be a simple process, in fact, even arbitrary, which it has ceased to be. And I'm sure you as responsible arbitrators and members of the council are taking due note of it. A defining feature of the 21st century is the global economic integration fueled by technological innovations, enhanced communication, and affordable transportation. These developments have sharply reduced relevance of national borders for trade, commerce, and investment activities. I do agree that globalization seems as if it's here to stay. An exponential growth of transboundary interactions necessitates formation of complex regulatory frameworks, including provisions for effective and efficient methods of dispute resolution. Yet, attempts to resolve international commercial or investment disputes in jurisdiction-tethered state forums have met with little success. This void has been successfully plugged by various alternate methods of dispute resolution, in particular, international arbitration. It would not be wrong to suggest that today arbitration is the most preferred mode of privately resolving a varied range of disputes. However, it must be kept in mind that it has taken the first place at the cost of mediation and conciliation, which I believe is much faster and less expensive than arbitration. There are problems, however, in mediation. And what is very interesting is that there is not a single university which you can go to and obtain a diploma or a degree in mediation. The same resistance which people had towards arbitration, in the sense that initially, if you remember, it was wrongly perceived by some sections of our profession that arbitration results in lesser income to lawyers because litigation lasts longer and lawyers are paid more. This is a reality. I am not being critical of any, either the demand for fees or the payment of fees. This is a fact. Now, with this resistance, the same resistance I find is operating against mediation and conciliation. And I've discussed this matter with Sriram Panchu, who's a very distinguished arbitrator, mediator also. And it seems that one of the things that could be a solution to this is the creation of a mediation bar, a bar association which specializes in mediation and which is qualified to deal with mediation. The other thing one could consider is allowing jeopardy. A mediation does not last too long. And it is understandable that advocates look to their fees having regard to the subject value, the value of the subject matter of the litigation. Maybe the mediation bar could be allowed to charge depending on the value of the litigation, because in effect they do solve a problem quickly, efficiently, and there is no appeal. Unlike an arbitration where there can be. I am not willing to say there can never be an appeal, because the ingenuity of the human mind is such that you can appeal against anything. But two more steps are necessary. One is compulsory pre-litigation mediation, and a provision in the law that the mediation agreement will result in a decree which can be enforced by a court. This compulsory pre-litigation mediation could also be pre-arbitration, because if the matter cannot be successfully mediated, it could go to the next arbitration alternate dispute resolution mechanism, and that is arbitration. One of the blocks in making mediation successful, which has prevented mediation from gaining ground, though I believe it is the most natural way of resolving a dispute. You say, whenever you have a problem, what do? You go to a friend, you go to somebody who can solve it. Mediation is a very natural way of resolving a dispute. One of the biggest stumbling blocks has been that the agreement cannot be enforced. Maybe it will be necessary to have an authority like the district judge in the district or a high court in the larger cities to certify that this is an agreement which has been freely entered into between parties, and therefore it will have the force of a decree. It will need an alteration in law, and you all know I am a judge, so the passing of the law is something which will have to come from some other quarters. This ADR in India, in fact, I would request the FICCI and the ICA to dedicate an entire conference to mediation and explore this possibility. Since I happen to be a chancellor of 4 national law universities, I have requested the vice chancellors of each one to start a course in mediation, which I hope will start very soon. And in fact, I think Mr. Panchu has drawn the necessary curriculum, etc., syllabus. You know, this system of alternate dispute resolution, which includes arbitration, of course, is very ancient in India. I am saying this for the benefit of the learned arbitrators who've come from other countries. There were systems called shrenis, which were like guilds, and kula. Kula is family or clan assemblies in India, and puga, tribunals that comprise of people dwelling in the same place, all of which closely approximate the present system of arbitration. What little material there is seems to suggest that these were systems not only of arbitration, but they were a combination of arbitration and mediation. And I see no reason why arbitrators in India or internationally should not have the flexibility to turn an arbitration proceeding into a mediation and vice versa. Despite its long history, the arbitration regime in post-independent India was considered to be archaic, unpredictable, and expensive. A regime that was meant to expeditiously resolve disputes was used to achieve the exact opposite result. Indiscriminate resort to courts, lengthy complicated procedures, lack of competent professionals, coupled with an inadequate understanding and acceptance of arbitration as a genuine alternative, meant that the arbitration regime no longer served the purpose which it was meant to. Such was the despair that one of our fine judges, Justice D.A. Desai, observed that the way in which arbitration worked made lawyers laugh and legal philosophers weep. It is in this background that the Arbitration and Conciliation Act was enacted. It marked the concerted effort to modernize Indian arbitration. Over the last decade or so, a catena of decision and a host of amendments, including fast-track arbitration, have attempted to transform India into a robust center for international and domestic arbitration, and the ICA is the finest example of it. Today, arbitration plays an essential role as an integral member of the global community and a trading and investment giant. How India engages with international arbitration has important ramifications on international transboundary flows of trade, commerce, and investment as a whole. It is therefore important to be cognizant of our current bearings and of what lies ahead. Success in endeavors aimed at transforming India into an international hub would depend on the diligence shown by various stakeholders. The arbitrator is a crucial component of successful arbitration. The standards to which they adhere have an important bearing on the independence and integrity of the arbitral process. Early practices of arbitration, which were confined to a few, were often governed by a set of self-prescribed values and norms. In recent times, globalization has led to a dramatic growth in cross-border transactions involving India, which has led to an increasing demand for cross-border arbitration. I am sure Mr. Khaitan has done his homework before making all the predictions he did, but I am glad that that is going to happen, that this is going to become more and more important in India. The net effect has been the emergence of an ultra-competitive arbitration marketplace characterized by an explosive surge of new entrants into the global community, global arbitration community. These new entrants, who often belong to diverse traditions, bring with them varied conceptions of what constitutes ethically acceptable conduct. Absence of common or defined ethical standards can sow seeds of discordance, which in the ultimate analysis would weaken the integrity of the international arbitration regime. In fact, just yesterday, somebody was talking of a world government, one government, and the question actually boiled out to that: on which principles are you going to govern the whole world if there is one government? And we came to the conclusion that it is first necessary that the international community gets together and decides what are the universal values which it seeks to enforce. And I think that is very important in terms in international arbitration. What is the value? Because it is depending on the value which judges hold and arbitrators hold and mediate that you decide what is right and what is wrong. And a lot of it is subconscious. So it is very necessary that arbitrators decide on what are the common universal values, maybe in business, but it is necessary to do that, I feel. Recent years have witnessed a major legal and policy reform in the arbitration landscape. These amendments have attempted to align the Indian arbitration regime with regimes in other leading jurisdictions. This presents, on the one hand, great opportunities as well as great challenges, which include ensuring availability of competent and quality arbitrators of high integrity. India is blessed with a talented and brilliant pool of individuals who can, with adequate training and orientation, act as arbitrators in the most complex of matters. Given the sheer diversity and quantum of matters being submitted to arbitration, the presence of a specialized arbitration bar with members who have not migrated from the general bar,
yes,
and who are working in close coordination with competent tribunals, institutions, is imperative. In fact, my inquiries revealed that there is only one diploma available which teaches arbitration as a course. Very few people, there's so much ignorance about arbitration that none of us should be surprised that few people resort to it. That being said, institutional arbitration has met with limited success in India. It is a well-known fact that Indian parties still show a strong preference for ad hoc over institutional arbitration. The Sri Krishna Committee identified the following factors which led to the 2019 amendments. A, lack of credible arbitral institutions, which is being remedied. Lack of governmental support for institutional arbitration. I think that is also being remedied, from what was quoted from the Niti Aayog. Judicial attitudes towards arbitration in general. And E, lack of specialist arbitration bar. While legislative and judicial efforts have attempted to address these factors, it is clear that for institutional arbitration to expand its footprints in India, it would require concerted support from all stakeholders. If we conceptualize international arbitration in a globalized era, we must also be cognizant of the synergistic opportunities available. As one scholar puts it, both international arbitration, IA, and AI, artificial intelligence, are leading alternatives to the status quo. I thank Mr. Khaitan for the reassurance that the judiciary is not going to be rendered redundant. And it's not likely to, because we are controlling the introduction of artificial intelligence. Whatever I know of artificial intelligence, it has great scope in dealing with repetitive tasks. Tasks which do not require human discretion. Say, calculations, tables, finding out which word occurs in which section of the brief. You know, there are cases which we have in our court, the record goes into 10, 15, 20,000 pages. The artificial intelligence system works with reading speeds of 1 million words per second. And it is very easy to give a command, say in a murder case, which accused had a knife, which accused led to the recovery of a knife, what was the blood stain on the knife, whose blood was it, which blood group was it, of which disease, and so on and so forth. Maybe I'm giving the wrong example in the community of arbitrators. It's something to do with criminal law. What I'm trying to say is that it can come up with information which is in any part of the case within seconds. Now, this is something which could assist judges and arbitrators greatly in deciding cases. The problem lies in the fact that the notion of an alternative is taken literally. As a result, in numerous instances, litigation is seen as the default mode. with parties turning to ADR only as a secondary option. This mindset needs to change, and unless it does, the ADR methods are likely to remain ineffective. And I must remind myself and this conference that we as judges deal with a huge range of disputes, not just commercial disputes. I know you are concerned only with that, but the fact that we have that workload which we have to deal with affects the resolution of these disputes. So really, it would be important to find out methods of assisting the judiciary in dealing with everything. And one of the methods is AI, specialized judges, specialized tribunals, compulsory pre-litigation and arbitration mechanisms, which could eventually lead to much more time to the judiciary to decide the seminal issues which sometimes rock the country. It is said an ounce of mediation is worth a pound of arbitration and a ton of litigation. Court annexed and private mediations through various centers operating in different parts of the country have reported significant levels of success. Specialized mediation services as part of hybrid mechanism, Med-Arb or Med-Arb-Med, methods are also provided by various institutions to resolve both commercial and investment disputes. There is a lot to be said about each of these topics, and I don't think I will go into each of them. The whole conference is meant for that, and I'm sure you will deliberate upon each one with precision, and the conference will yield many, many solutions which ICA, FICCI, and the entire international community could absorb. I believe this conference would provide an appropriate platform for celebrating past achievements, identifying existing and future concerns, and formulating possible solutions. Given the collective wisdom and depth of excellence of panelists, I am confident that today's discussion will generate concrete action points for each stakeholder. I wish the conference all success. Thank you. Jai Hind.